Balsall, to you be praise and glory forever. In the darkness of this age that is passing away, may the light of your presence, which the saints enjoy, surround our steps as we journey on. May we reflect your glory this day, and so be made ready to see your face in the heavenly city where night shall be no more. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God, forever.
Amen.
And a prayer of the Caribbean Conference of Churches. Thank you, O Lord our God, for all that you have done to sustain us. In the Caribbean there are so many things that give pleasure. Beaches, mountains, valleys, trees, fruits, and flowers. Indeed, all nature celebrates you in this part of your creation. Thank you for the people who dwell in these territories and far away throughout the world, that in them we see a reflection of all the races of the world. Thank you for your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, for his life, his mission, his teaching, his sufferings, his death and resurrection, and that this Jesus, who is our Saviour, lives today. Please be seated.
Reverend Catherine Grylls, Reverend David Tudor, fellow Barbadians, friends of Barbados. Good afternoon. It is traditional that the Prime Minister, as head of government at this time of year, issues an official message to Barbadians at home and abroad to mark the anniversary of independence. It is my understanding that the official message has been prepared but has not yet been released by the office of the Prime Minister. The message will, of course, be made available to you in due course, but I believe it would be appropriate for me at this time to say a few words in circumstances. I am Minister George Hudson, for those of you who are not aware, my portfolio, international business and international transport. Let me say it's a distinct pleasure to bring you greetings as we celebrate this 43rd anniversary of the independence of our beloved country. It is doubly so since this service is being held in Birmingham, a city which has been home to hundreds of Barbadians since the 1960s. In this regard, I commend the organizers of this service, second generation Barbadians, and Friends Association, the yeoman work that you've done over the years for Barbadians and for Barbados in this community. And I understand that there are or were other organizations prior to the second generation of Barbadians. And of course, the work that has been done by those particular organizations over the years is commended. We cannot thank you enough for what you and thousands of our fellow countrymen who came to Britain in the 50s and 60s have contributed both to the building of post-war Britain and Barbados as well.
So let us stand and sing praise to God as we sing hymn number 506. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hands have made.
Thank you.
false rumours, and do not help a guilty man by giving false evidence. Do not follow the majority when they do wrong, or when they give evidence that perverts justice. Do not show partiality to a poor man at his trial. If you happen to see your enemy's cow or donkey running loose, take it back to him. If his donkey has fallen under its load, help him get the donkey to its feet again. Don't just walk away. Do not deny justice to a poor man when he appears in court. Do not make false accusations and do not put an innocent person to death. For I will condemn anyone who does such an evil thing. Do not accept a bribe, for a bribe makes people blind to what is right and ruins the cause of those who are innocent. Do not ill-treat a foreigner. You know how it feels to be a foreigner, because you were foreigners in Egypt. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Exodus chapter 23, verse 2. Do not follow the crowd in doing wrong. In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Three chapters earlier, in Exodus chapter 20, the people received the gift of the Ten Commandments. And the chapters that follow provide the detail of what it means to be faithful to the Ten Commandments, summed up in that verse that Jocelyn read, do not follow the crowd in doing wrong. I was there on the night of the 30th of November 1966 at the garrison Savannah when the Union flag came down and the blue gold and black flag of Barbados went up, and it rained, and it rained. The last gift of the British was rain. Was anybody else there at the garrison that night? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Not sure, 6.5. In gaining independence, Barbados was following in the footsteps of Jamaica, Trinidad, and Guyana. It had been a long road. 200 years of slavery, followed by emancipation, freedom. Freedom to do what? Freedom to go where? Freedom to work for those who had previously owned you. The Berlin Wall, we have just been reflecting, was knocked down some 20 years ago. But to many, it still exists as a state of mind. Slavery was abolished, but it persisted, and it still persists as a state of mind. And for those of mixed race, it was even harder to know what to feel about our history, slave and slave owner in the same bloodstream, bonded and free. We all strive to gain some sense of our identity, of our history, of our place in the scheme of things. We grew up in a colonial era with a colonial mindset. I remember standing at the bottom of Tudor's Gap on my Lord's Hill, near there by Breckneck Hill, when the Queen and Prince Philip would pass in the silver shadow, I think it was, and we would wave our flags. And all the children that year were named Elizabeth. And you could tell, like you could tell the age of a tree, you could tell the visits of the royal family by how old all the Charleses are, and the Anns, and the Edwards, and the Andrews. I think by the time Sophie came along, we'd given up on that sort of thing. My we had British passports. Generations before us had fled to Panama for a better life. Then there was London, then there was New York and Toronto. For some, there was a feeling of exile. We understood the words of the psalmist in Psalm 137, "By the rivers of Babylon we sat down and wept. How can we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land?" Many who came here in the 50s and the 60s went to church as they were used to doing, and were told by a church warden, "There must be some mistake. Your church is down the road, round the corner, somewhere else, not here." No surprise, really. For many years, when my father, who was also a priest, was in charge of St. Cyprian's Church in Belleville, we as a family went there. And to my shame, it was a long, long time before I realized the coincidence that all the black people were sitting in the second half of the church, and all the white people were sitting in the front half of the church. When I worked out that I was mixed race, I thought I should sit in the aisle. The country we grew up in had at its center, absolute center, a faith in God. Jesus, the Messiah, the friend. My grandmother would never make an arrangement to meet you tomorrow, next week, next year, whatever, without adding the words, "if God spare life." And sometimes in exasperation, Ella, who was about 108 when I knew her at the top of Breakneck Hill, would often exclaim, "Lord, come for your world." As though he were around the corner, ready to come back and take over. Just a matter of interest, can I discover how many of you actually grew up in Barbados? Whatever decade, a little show of hands. You grew up in Barbados. Thank you, Piana. Who of you were not, did not grow up in Barbados? Show of hands. Well, never mind. It's because we who grew up in Barbados, whether we ourselves accepted it, we were surrounded by the fact of God as a close friend. We had this rich heritage in our schooling, in our home life, in our extended families. And each of you will have your own particular heroes. You know, I took a group 2 weeks ago to Jerusalem. And when we were there, we went to the house where it was supposed Mary grew up. Mary, who grew up with her mother Anne. And I have a special affinity for Anne, really, because who would have taught Jesus? Who would have taught Jesus his prayers, if not his grandmother? And when we were at Anne's house, I thought, you know, and I hope that she was alive still when Jesus died, because Mary will have had need of her mother. And for many of us, it was the grandparent who was there for us, the grandparent who taught us our prayers, the grandparent who listened to our troubles, the grandparent who was always home at the end of our day. And today, perhaps, we have a feeling of exile. Those who grew up in the Caribbean, we feel away from home. Those who grew up in the England of former days, away from home. We salute those who set up associations like this, the second generation, because it's important to plug in to the energy that you have, the energy that we have, the shared memory, the social, the memory, to minimize the alienation and to combat social isolation. God knows we need that fellowship now more than ever. The disciples, after the crucifixion, went back to their trades. And the risen Christ found them by the lake, doing what they had always done, fishing. We are called by the risen Christ not to grow tired. I love that vision at the end of Isaiah 40. Even youths shall faint and grow weary. Young men shall stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord shall renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. Soar, run, walk. That is the challenge for you and me here in Birmingham, London, Essex, wherever we come from. Soar, run, walk. The country we grew up in inherited a confusing mixture of oppressed and oppressor, slave and free. But you and I have to find our own path, based and built on all of that, but a new path for the 21st century. And it's confusing, because the messages we received were subtle about who was better than whom. I remember when my brother decided to grow his hair into a huge afro. My grandmother asked, "Will you mash up your hair, fucker?" Message, straight hair better than curly. Common societal inquiries like, who he going out with? Marlene. Is that their skin girl? Who he think he is? Message, clear skin, better than dark. Even the language we used. I grew up bilingual. English in the classroom and Bajan in the playground. Bajan at home just to annoy my English mother. When my brother was ill, I would ask solicitously of my mother. I would not ask, is he ill? I would inquire, what do he? Message, Queen's English, better than dialect. Today we are called to walk day by day and create a community that is a magnet for those who have lost their way. We can take as our text Zechariah, where he says, in that day, 10 men will take hold of your robe and say, let us go with you, for we have seen that God is with you. We knew that in our youth in Barbados. Do we know it now in our middle age, in our older age, in England? Do we know it? We have seen that God is with you. Can we create here and elsewhere a church that is a hospital for sinners? That we should put up a sign above the door, come in, trespassers will be forgiven. I remember in my first parish in Plumstead, Southeast London, a woman saying to me, I ain't going in that church. It's too full of hypocrites. I said, come in, no, there's always room for one more. Isaiah 43:18, forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Isaiah 44, this is what the Lord says. He who made you, who formed you in the womb, and who will help you. I will pour water on the thirsty land and streams on the dry ground. One will say, I belong to the Lord. Another will call himself by the name of Jacob. Still another will write on his hand, the Lord's. I was in my teenage years when Jeanette Lane Clark and Alfred Pragnell, and my dad's cousin, Joe Tudor, were striving to make us unashamed of our culture and our language, our roots, and especially our humor. Because it was our humor that caused us to survive. It was our humor that caused those slaves to survive 200 years of slavery. It was the humor that made us free. Free from the pigeonholes that others would seek to impose. Free from the stereotypes to which society said we must conform. Humor in the very language. When someone that we love is being maligned, we can say, left he out. You hear what I say? Leffy out. You ain't about to wash your mouth and eat. Or when we feel cheated by a suit or a dressmaker, we can say, he should make another one and never drop dead by his I hear he learned he trained in Glendary. A new century, new structures, but the same faith. and the fellowship that we have here and in places and gatherings like this across these next couple of weeks as we celebrate 43 years of independence, 43 years of progress, 43 years of greater freedom, and with the freedom has come increased responsibility. Forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on towards the prize for which God has called me heavenwards in Christ Jesus. And you know, Paul wrote those words in prison, focusing on what is ahead. So what imprisons us now?